One of the hardest parts as a GIS consultant or a GIS professional isn't actually writing code or creating maps or creating dashboards or developing UIs that are so interactive. It's actually being able to charge your work accordingly. So, are you charging too little? Are you charging too much? Are you undervaluing yourself? Are you overvaluing your work? Where are you when it comes to the pricing? So stick with me. By the end of this video, you know exactly how to value or how to price your work as a GIS consultant or a GIS professional. So let's be real. Pricing is a key tricky because most of the clients don't fully understand what actually goes on in these GIS projects. And by that, I mean the technical aspects of the project. And by just looking at what they basically require as the end product, they might, of course, not be able to value the work accordingly, or there could be either an overshot or an undershot when it comes to the value that they are attached to the work. So your work as a professional is basically being able to guide the client on this when it comes to the different elements. I know there are timelines. There are things like what are the components, what are the modules to be done, what is the output, what are the features that need to be incorporated. So in this regard, because the client does not understand all these technical aspects, for them, they want the end product. It's your job to be able to value your work accordingly. And remember, you might underquote your work and it becomes a disadvantage to you, or you might overvalue your work and the client vanishes. So either way, it could be tricky, but we are here to basically understand how we need to go about it. So on top of that, GIS work basically never fits into one. We can fit it into one box. Of course, it overlaps with so many other software out there, data science platforms. We have analysis ecosystems or maybe project management. So with all that, you need to basically bring all that ideas together for you to be able to value your work accordingly. So the first step is to acknowledge that pricing isn't actually only priced against time, but the actual pricing is on value. So stick with me as I show you how. So think of it this way. If a logistics company hires you to basically work on a route optimization algorithm or platform for them, in this scenario, the solution probably saves 10 or 15% of their running costs when ready or when in use. So in such a scenario, you don't even need to know, or the owner or the client basically will not care about whether you used Python or used which kind of platform to develop their solution. But what they will see is the 15% that you've saved the organization. And this is their driving motive. And this is why they actually needed someone who can actually do the solution for them. So in such a case, you see, we are not looking at the time, we are looking at the value. It's the 15% that you are saving the organization. So in such a scenario, it's always good, or a pro tip that I would say, it's always frame your pricing based on the client's outcomes, not only on the time or the effort that you've put in. So with that said, remember, clients aren't just paying for the hours. So they are paying for the years of your learning, your expertise, your experience that you've been in the industry, and that all the risk that you put on your shoulders to basically deliver that solution to them. So always be on top of the game. So now let's break down into how you can actually base your pricing, or basically what you can call the pricing models. And here they are. One, you would actually go with the hourly or the time aspect of things. So what we would basically call hourly rate, I know this is very common among many projects. You've seen maybe if it's a job, per hour, this is the cost, or this is the value that we are according to this project, and this is what we are ready to pay. So hourly rate is great, and this is great for short term or undefined projects. Why short term? An example, if for example you're cleaning a shape file data that or a shape file that has been delivered to you from the field, this is basically something that you can do within 2 or 3 hours and you are done and it's off the table. So when you tell someone that this one I'm going to charge maybe $40 or $50 per hour, that is perfectly okay. And this is again depending on where you are located, your expertise and your level of consultancy, because of course not all levels will price the same. The other model is what you call the per project model. This is best when the scope is clear, and this you find in most cases this is for projects that for example have phases. So you have phase one, you have phase two, you have phase three, or milestone one, milestone two, and milestone three. So if the scope is so clear, you can actually charge or price based on the project. So an example, if someone wants a dashboard where you can display health centers or health facilities in some region, that is something that you already know the outcomes, you already know the scope, and you can actually charge per project. So that model is basically what you call subscription or retainer model. And this is usually very tricky, more so for this this side of the world, because depending on where you are, remember, all these opportunities are based on where you are. Opportunity, environment aspects matters a lot, in my opinion. And of course, the retainer or the subscription option will of course be perfect for projects that are ongoing. And by ongoing, I mean projects that maybe are recurring, and they do not have a specific end period or a specific end time. So if, for example, an entity wants a certain project done, and this, for example, is on monthly basis, or it's on a specific period, you can actually have a retainer where you say maybe monthly, this is the amount that I will receive or I will need for this specific project. And then the fourth model is what we call the value-based pricing. And this is actually like the top tier. And the value-based is what we would say the gold standard. So the gold standard of pricing basically dictates that if your GIS apps, for example, you're helping a mining company to actualize a solution, or as an example I gave earlier, where you may be saving the company 15 or 10% of their cost, this is something that you can actually negotiate based on that value that you're bringing to them. So remember, as we said, it's the gold standard, but it's because depending on the entities that you find and your level of your consultancy or your profession, you basically might find these clients, and it's actually a good way of pricing. So all the four models or the four pricing models, you've seen that they are all different and each fits a specific case. This is because, of course, not all projects are the same, not all clients are the same, not all scenarios are also the same. So each model has its pros and cons. Of course, you can start with the first one, which is basically the hourly or the hourly or project-based pricing. And then as you navigate all up way to the last one. So remember, you can do a mix as a professional or as a consultant. Of course, you might have one or two projects. You might have one project that is per project. Another one probably is on retainer options. And you can also maybe have hourly date depending on the project. So how do you know what to actually charge? So here's a simple formula. For example, if you take income or what you need for a specific period, and this we can actually target as desired annual income plus what we call the business expenses. You as a business or as a consultant, of course, you have some expenses. You have internet, you have transport, you have printing, you have any kind of expense. So think of yourself as a business. And then on top of that, you need to add taxes. So, for example, if you're in a certain country where a tax rate, for example, 15% or 16%, you need to put that into consideration. If you add the desired annual income, the business expense, and the taxes, and then you divide that by the billable hours that you have in a year, that should basically give you an hourly rate. So you could use this as the base hourly rate. And as I mentioned, your billable hours per year will also vary depending on the person or depending on the time or the project that you want to allocate. So an example, if you want to earn $60,000 a year, $60,000 USD a year, And your expenses, which are basically software licenses, internet, workspace, transport, and all that, comes to around 10,000. And then you add taxes, which are about 15,000 USD. That is around 85,000 total. So if you can realistically bill $1,500 a year, that's about $57 per hour. So adjust based on experience and the region. So for example, in America and Europe, $75 to $150 per hour is normal for mid-level consultants. In other regions, rates might be lower, but don't undercut yourself just to get work. Of course, I know sometimes you might struggle in your career and you might, for example, be able to want to get such jobs that are probably low. But of course, if you were able to come back to your level, of course, be able to make sure that you don't undercut yourself. Remember, clients aren't just paying for the hours. They are paying for the years that you've experienced, this work, your learning, your investment in knowledge and tools that you've been able to invest over the time. And that is the risk that you're taking off their shoulders and you're able to deliver to them. Also, remember, the other aspects I've seen in the industry is that most of the clients see only the final outputs. And these final outputs, of course, have very good UIs, very enticing to use, very fascinating or very good. But they don't see the time you've spent to do all that. You have data cleaning, you have data conversions, transformations, you have setting up your local environment, setting up the servers, testing, documentation. It's a lot of work. And of course, that's why you need to break it down. And one trick is to use, for example, modules or what you call packages. So a basic one would, for example, just break down from maybe if it's the initial or the inception report and all that, this percentage, if it's a certain, I've developed the dashboard to a specific level, this percentage, if you are finished to a certain percentage, 80%, then pay this amount. So these packages, what we're talking about is basically breaking down the project into sections. So you could probably do three packages or four packages depending on how you agree with the client. So if a project is valued at 100%, you could, for example, say after signing the contract and the initial of the inception, that is 30%. Then after you deliver the first sample of the dashboard, another 20%. Then after you deliver that and you be able to train the staff, another 30%. And after you've done with the compiling the reports and the documentation and the hosting and everything, the 20%. So you've broken down that project into four sections, and those four sections will basically form milestones or packages that you can deliver or that you can negotiate with the client. And this is what they'll pay you against your work. So instead of just pricing everything at once, you can break down into those sections or into those packages, and it will help you be able to actually get the actual price. The biggest mistake is undervaluing yourself. Yeah. If a client pushes back on cost, don't immediately drop your rate, because cheap is not always the solution. Instead, reduce the scope. Okay, so you can offer a few features. So within the four packages that we had, you can look at the features that you can actually drop. So you drop some features, but you stick to the same price. So if the scope is too big for the client, you can help them narrow it down. And for example, you can agree on a price that will be appropriate for them. And that way you'll be able to protect your client, and also you protect your value. And you also be able to stay flexible when working within a project. Here is the bottom line. Don't just give a price based on guesswork. Just don't guess a number because you wanted maybe to buy something that was those 2,000 USD, and you want this work, for example, is worth 10,000, and you just say a number. The client, for example, might be so happy because they've seen someone who can do something that they needed, or they would have spent 10,000 for 2,000. But on your end, it will be so tough. So understand your worth, choose the right pricing model, always connect your work to client results. And with that, you'll be able to actually come up with the right pricing, and that pricing will actually also be agreeable with the client. And they'll be able to give you the job. If you ever find jobs or tasks that are fixed, so most of them you find the client, for example, says, I'm looking for this person who can do ABCD, but the cost or the amount that we pay is this. So in most cases, some of those projects are usually very considerate, and they've figured or they put into consideration all these elements that you've put down. So if you get someone who is able to break, or a client who is able to break down everything into piecemeal, and they're able to price it based on what they have, then that's good for you and it will be a good job. And in such case scenario, such clients will be able to work with them so nicely, because they already understand the scope, they already understand the what goes behind the scenes, and they want you as a professional to help them offload some of this work within the organization. So this is a good one, and you can still proceed. So now I want to hear from you. How do you charge your GIS work? What do you do? Is it hourly? Is it project based? Is it milestone based? Is it a subscription or retainer option? What do you basically do? Leave a comment below there, and you'll help others as we grow the industry in the geospatial sector. So, and if you found this useful, of course, be able to share with other within your network, share widely, and this is how you help the channel grow. And also subscribe to the channel for more of such videos in the future. And see you in the next one.